Just highlights the importance of having your equipment ready for the season. getting it checked out, making sure that vitamins do release. This gentleman, this is during a World Cup downhill, and he didn't see it in real-time motion. He had to watch it again in slow motion. But these guys turn up their binders so the din setting was how the tension of the binding. You know, mine runs at about 6 or 7. Aggressive skiers maybe up to 10 or 12. His is about 24. And it's just, it's like being bolted into your ski. His binding didn't release. He didn't release. And he does a 360 on his leg. He ended up with an amputation of his lower leg because of the amount of soft tissue damage that was done. Being aware of, again, I apologize, I didn't get these things going as we come along here, but knowing where you are, if you're in the park, you should have a physics minor, if not a physics major, to know what the speeds are for the jump and where to land. And the like, and one of the more common things for skiers and snowboarders is overshooting the jump or undershooting landing on the crest or the knuckle, and taking a landing flat instead of getting the torsion of the slope of the hill that comes down. Conditions play a big part of it. One of our busiest months as far as knee injuries is in April, and the reason is that the conditions just vary throughout the run from top and bottom. You have icy conditions at the bottom, you have slush at the bottom. Or ice at the top, slush at the bottom, on the side of the hill can be very well made. It leads to catching an edge and having the ski take off, and that's what happened to our racer here. If you look at the numbers down below, he's going about 75 miles an hour. When he just catches an edge, goes into a panel, and ends up dislocating his knee. You see him sitting on the side holding his knee, but he also fractured his neck. There's sort of a spine fracture that we call it a distracting injury. You're so focused on one thing that it's one of the things that we teach all our doctors that are involved with ski team coverage is you have to examine everything head to toe to make sure that you aren't missing something, that the obvious is not taken away from something else that may be going on. He ended up having surgery on both areas, but that was pretty much the end of his racing career. Collisions happen, and depending on your bias, it's either I got run into by a snowboarder, or I got run into by a skier. It happens both directions, unfortunately. And we have situations where I was just taking a nice run down, I'm skiing the fall line, and all of a sudden this guy gets in my way. And this is during a World Cup race. And this official, that for whatever reason, decides he's going to cross the hill, is not check conditions above, and thinks he's got right away. So he goes right in front of this racer. That's kind of the reaction to that, which actually this had not a bad ending. But on the other hand, these things can be somewhat catastrophic when there's a little music here. But the scout came over, jumped, and not expecting to see it, but she actually came out not too bad, just an ankle fracture. He ended up with a pretty significant head injury. And it stresses some of the other things of knowing the terrain, knowing where things are, but also we'll get briefly into the skier responsibility code. Part of it is you don't stop in areas where you can't be seen from above. One of my favorite comments that I get is, it was the last word of the day. It's like, for now. I was skiing more of a day. So how do we solve some of these things? And as I talked about earlier, equipment is the one thing you should be looking at. Now, it's the easiest thing to do is get your equipment in, have it tuned, get your bindings properly set, and make sure things are tuned up for the conditions that you're going to be in. If you're going to be on hardtack, you need an edge. If you're going to be in the trees and powders, you really don't want to have skinny skis on those areas. So you have the proper equipment, have it ready. ACL awareness. By the way, this binding that's seen here is termed ACL binding. They're marketing it as a binding that prevents all ACL injuries, which the problem is the upward toe release just doesn't happen. So when people get in the back seat and the pressure's going to the toe, it traditionally is a bad release system. But if you're looking for a binding that may give you some advantage, that's the one. ACL awareness looks at the way that people fall when they get an injury, and it goes back to a group out of Vermont Safety Research Group that studied videos of people that fell and looked at common denominators on why did things happen, why did these people tear their ACL. And the things that they found were in common with the people that got injured is they tried to get up while they're still moving, and they're crashing. It's like, oh boy, I'm just going to get up and ski on. It's a bad idea because you're down low, your hips are low, and there's a lot of pressure that when you engage and ski, you know, things are going to go. They're off balance, they're trying to recover, they're getting in the back seat, they're trying to pull themselves up. And the other thing is if they also go to sit down and put their hips below the level of their knee, it sets things up. Technically, it's basically like being in the back seat when you're skiing. So your arm is back, you're off balance to the rear, and what happens is the weight gets to the inside edge of your uphill ski, and it starts to carve, and the pressures go to your knee, just take your ACL off in an instant. So they came up with things that they recommended to try to incorporate into your skiing, the way you ski, the way you fall, to make sure it doesn't happen. If you watch this, this is Herman Meyer, and he does everything perfectly. His hands are forward, his weight's forward. Don't straighten your legs when you fall, and don't try to get up. So he just rode it out for about 100 yards, and came back 2 days later and won a gold medal in Super G, the Olympics in Nagano. It helps to be an Austrian. Any Austrians? Their thigh size is about as big as my chest, or these guys just don't get hurt by and large like the skinny leg Americans, which isn't true, I guess, because they're the equivalent of our football players. They're playing football, they're on the ski. So again, it's proper technique and staying aggressive centered over your skis, and if you fall, don't try to bounce back up, just ride it out. Don't bang your legs up because you don't want to get your hips below your knees. The skier responsibility code, put this up because you've seen it 100 times, you've never read it. You probably won't read it tonight either, but it's basically how you know where you're skiing and how you respect other people on the hill, and it is a key factor. You don't want to be responsible for somebody else's injury. Happens all too often. Know where you're skiing. Don't stop in an area where somebody's going to come up at a high speed and all of a sudden run into you, literally and figuratively. Knowing conditions, knowing the terrain, and again, it's when you get into the anybody go in the park frequently besides Sandra? Any park skiers? I mean, it really is. I think they need to have somebody out doing calculations up there, wind velocity and how high you go and what your speed is on takeoff, because you hear it very often that people get beyond the landing and they hit a flat landing instead of a slope. It's the same thing if you're going up the trees, to know what the conditions are, to make sure there's adequate coverage because obstacles happen and trees hurt. That's all I can say on that. And then conditioning. Put on your Superman suit, get out there, but the suit probably itself won't do enough, and that's where everyone's going to give you all the key out of that. And that's really where the last run of the day comes into play. It's not the knucklehead phrase, but it's fatigue plays a role. And you've been out all day, and the last run just too often is where you're getting a point of fatigue, and that's where conditioning comes into play. You're strong, you're ready, and when my wife says it, I'm just going to stop for the question. Okay. So, you hurt your knee, what do you do? You don't have to go running in every time. But there's certain things that you look at, if it doesn't seem that bad, the basic things that are the expressed ice compression elevation. As long as you don't have a head injury, you have inflammatory medication, it's okay. If you bonk your head, you don't want to take it, you might increase a lot of bleeding time. So aspirin, anti-inflammatories, if you hit your head, don't do it, otherwise it's okay. Light exercise, and it should be pain-free. You can get on the bike stand, give some time for things to settle down, see how things are doing. If things aren't doing better over a couple days, then you should start thinking about getting things checked out. What are the other things that you should be looking for that are kind of warning signs out there? When people talk about hearing or feeling a pop in the knee, a pop is one of the things that happens with a ligament injury. It's like a top rope that, you know, pops and you can hear it, feel it, goes right through your bones to your ears. It's one of the things that it can be bad. It can be your ACL, anterior cruciate ligament, which is when people talk about going out the knee, that's the one they're talking about. Or a medial collateral ligament, that's something that can heal on its own and may have the same type of presentation if you're feeling a pop. Swelling is a general barometer of the degree of injury. So if we've got a swollen knee, a tight knee, there's fluid buildup inside the knee joint. That's one of the things I'm looking at to try and assess what's going on. It's a general barometer of injury within the knee and severity. Typically, if it happens acutely after an injury, it indicates bleeding inside the joint. Instability, loss of strength, you worry about ligament damage or muscle injury. Pain with weight bearing is another factor that you shouldn't be hobbling around in. I'll show you a picture here in a minute of a guy that broke his tibia and walked around railies, walked around for a couple of days because he knew that his ACL, that it was a fracture that needed to be fixed. So there are things that happen in just in general guideline. Loss of motion can be from swelling itself can cause stiffness and loss of motion, but it can also be a torn meniscus or a loose body, something blocking movement inside the knee joint. Something that, you know, demands more immediate attention. Catching and locking similarly is something getting stuck in the knee joint for lack of motion. And then if it's something that follows okay, but it's pain's getting worse or just not improving over the course of 2 to 4 days, time to get it checked out. So we talk about treatment, we talk about the different things, you know, anatomically they get injured, for bone injuries, fracture is the description for the injury. For the joint surface, it's the articular cartilage that can get injured. The menisci or the fibrocartilage ribs that sit between the bones, we make every effort to repair when we can. For ligament injuries, we refer to as sprains, muscle tendon injuries as strains. So just some of the basics on that. Then going through the anatomy that we look at, So on the left side is just, if you see the there, there's a part of it. Okay, so this is what we're looking at anatomically inside the joints. This is the front of the knee, this is the patella up top here, and this is the femur here. The front part of the femur here, we call the femoral trochlea. It's a little bit of a grooved area. The patella flies back and forth in that area. Coming down into the knee, this is a right knee, this is the medial joint. So this is the femur again here, tibia down below, and this structure right here is the medial meniscus, and that's the area right here that we can see. So the meniscus helps to transfer the pressure from the femur to the tibia. It spreads it out over a wider area so the pounds per square inch are diminished, less stress going across the joint. That's when going, this stuff we put in the probe, the tip of this probe is about 5 millimeters in length, so a little bit less than a quarter of an inch. Just to give you an idea of the magnification of bone. That's the ACL, anterior cruciate ligament. It has a synovial membrane that covers it. And behind that, to the right was the posterior cruciate ligament. Now we go over to the lateral side. We're looking over here now. This is the femur, this is the ACL right here. Lateral femoral condyle right here. Lateral meniscus and the tibia right down here. And this is here. The medial meniscus is more fixed and rigid than the lateral meniscus, and so when the tibia shifts, there's a lot of pressure that goes onto the meniscus and that will cause tearing of the meniscus. Because of the pressures that are transferred from the femur to the tibia and spread out by the meniscus, it's the importance of the role of the meniscus itself and why we make efforts to repair instead of remove. I started my orthopedic training back in 1980, and that was kind of, arthroscopy was not all over the place. And most of the guys that are the attendings where I trained didn't do it. As the first year resident, one of the things we did, we prepped the leg, scrubbed it, went out to the scrub seat, the attending went in, put his cotton gloves on, and would be scrubbing away, and we'd look in, the attendee might come out the window, open up the meniscus, and say, hey, what's going on? I'm looking out already, 5 minutes. Another case. So things have changed a bit. You're going to have to scout later, turn these things out, but again, repair is the standard that we're looking for. Fractures, again, this is the gentleman I talked about. Injured his knee, he and his buddies said it's an ACL injury, you're fine, whatever. And you can see right here, this fracture line right here, and this is actually the surface of the bone. It's crushed down, should be up even with this, so the front part's broken down and separated. So with fractures, you look at, is it within the joint or intra-articular? Does it affect stability? Is it displaced? Displacement in the joint, we don't tolerate, because you're left with an unsmooth joint, it's going to be arthritis. Does, in a younger person, does it involve the growth plate? So we refer to this as a metal deficiency. It's what you need is they have metal put in, screws get their back up in place, fixed. And again, going back to, is it something that if you can't put weight on it, we worry about fractures and injuries that can be quite severe. When we talk about meniscus injuries, so when you cut a meniscus into what we call this a cross-section view, the meniscus comes out in here, the femur and the tibia is flatter than the femur, so it kind of works as a shim to spread the load out. But this is a meniscus that the blood vessel's been injected with India ink, and what it shows is the vascular pattern only comes out a few millimeters into the body of the meniscus. And that's why when we look at why we can't repair all the meniscus tears. If the tear is back in here, it is close to the blood supply, has a better potential for healing. If it's out in here, there just isn't the potential. The meniscus is white through this area, where you have vascularity and has a reddish orangish hue to it. So as brilliant as we are, we call this a red-white zone, where red meets white, whatever. It just indicates that that's the, where the vascularity is, the more better chance for healing. So just when we look at these tear patterns, so this is a meniscus, this is the edge, the back part, there's a tear that just splits right into it. And again, so it's in the white area, it's white on white, it's just not going to heal. Unfortunately, this is the type we take out, with one exception. If you have a young person, 18 or under, they heal like frogs, they'll grow new legs, and you cut it off, they can actually heal these. And we had some that have been torn all the way through, stitched back together, and have healing potential. This is a tear that is in that red area. This is actually in the back of the knee, where the femur is here, part of the knee is there, and we're looking into the back where we have this split in the meniscus right there. So that's a great area for healing back in that area. So just briefly, we talked about the different zones, 0, 1, 2, 3, 0 being out in the red, white, where 0, 1 knee, and then we get further we get away, we just aren't doing the repair. So if it's 3 to 5 millimeters, we are looking at excision. If it's closer to the rim, we put stitches in like this to bring the 2 inches of the meniscus back together to hold while it heals. Articular cartilage, sometimes this defies diagnosis until you get in there, and it's usually worse than you expect. Cartilage doesn't show up on an x-ray. You see the bone, you don't see the cartilage. And a lot of times it's by suspicion that you have somebody that they're complaining of catching or locking, that had an impact injury, the MRI doesn't always give us information. So we go by what the mechanism of injury was, they had a catching locking, and a lot of times our, first thing that we see that really gives a hint, we see a loose body floating around, and it's articular cartilage, it came from somewhere, so you keep looking, and you find a hole in the articular cartilage. So this is basically normal cartilage, and a chunk came out of here, and that dark area is down in bare bone. And this is, potentially a big injury left untreated, that hole is going to be bigger over time. So we want to do something to fill in that hole. There are a few different ways we can take care of it, and it's kind of all through here, which is either stimulating the body to form cartilage, and fortunately it doesn't form what we call hyaline cartilage, a natural cartilage that's over a joint. It'll form more of a fibrocartilage or a scar tissue patch, but it's not a bad substitute. We can take cartilage from one area and transfer it. We can take it from a cadaver donor. And there's another way that's out there where we take a cartilage from juvenile donors, cadavers, and it has a higher cell viability, and it's a new technique that may be kind of a big way in the future to use that to put it in to get it to grow. This is what we do with an osteochondral allograft. They basically take a cadaver tissue. This is a fresh graft. This is a little bit thicker blood than we try to take a 6 to 8 millimeter thickness instead of a 10 millimeter. We transfer it from there into the patient where they've got this bare spot and put it in place to fill that point and get actual hyaline cartilage back into the area. Ligament injuries. Ligaments connect bones and control motion so things stay together, stay stable. Anybody know what's wrong with that picture? So this is a person that got caught in an avalanche and dislocated his knee. And we reference the direction of the dislocation by what the more distal, further away from the heart part goes. So this is an anterior dislocation with tibia dislocated this way. This is a shoulder bike. And when you do that, you're going to have at least 3 out of 4, if not all 4, major ligaments. So you have the ACL, PCL, anterior, posterior, cruciate ligaments, medial, lateral, collateral ligaments, medial being on the inner side, lateral on the outer side of the knee. And if you look at this, the ACL attaches here and here, and it doesn't stretch like a rubber band. So it's going to go. Four ligaments again. The MCL is one that in most cases is treated non-operatively unless it's combined with other injuries and it's grossly lax. Lateral collateral ligament is one that doesn't get injured as often. If you think about football injuries, people getting clipped and hit from the outside of the knee is putting stress to the inner side and bows to be open this way to tear the MCL. LCL injuries on the outer side, it's rare that you get hit from the inside of the knee, but we see it in skiers when they hit trees and the leg wraps around the tree. Trees usually win in that case. And it's one that it's more often that we have to repair or reconstruct the ligament, reconstruct and rebuild it with some other tissue. Posterior cruciate ligament goes the other direction from the ACL. So ACL is going this way. This is the PCL. And this is the type of injury we'll see, again, with collision. Somebody runs into something, see it in car accidents frequently, but also skier versus tree, where the tibia gets hit on the tree, it just drives the lower leg back and injures the PCL. Most PCL injuries are treated non-operatively, but isolated. The body has a big capacity to compensate for it with applied strength to protect it. But in a grossly unstable knee or in a multi-ligament injured knee, reconstruction becomes indicated. And then finally, with ACL injuries, this is a normal ACL here, and this is what we call a mob bending tear. There are hundreds of fibers of ligament tissue that are combined to make the ACL, and when it tears it, if it's mid-substance, you look at it, just multiple fibers, you just can't patch it back together. So, by and large, these end up being reconstructed if we go the surgical route. And it's something that there's a bit of a bias here. If you put a brace on your knee, you walk in the store, you're going to have 100 people say, I hurt my teeth, me too. And I'll give you all kinds of advice and do the whole thing, right? But not everybody has to have an ACL reconstruction. The main indication is for an unstable knee. We try to look at the profile of the person in terms of their activity level or demands, what they want to get back to doing to help them make that decision. We do have hyperactive adults here and people that are in their 50s, 60s, 70s, and it's important for them to get back to skiing. But there are other options that are out there, and it's part of what Alan's going to talk about tonight is the whole group that we refer to as COPERS. So one of the options is looking at rehab, rehabilitation, work on strength, consider bracing, and see how it matches into your demands and what activities that you want to do. Repair, when I first got here in 1988, Dr. Steinman was still here, and I would say 90% of his ACLs he did repairs on, and when he left here 2.5 years later, 90% were reconstruction. So it was just a transition period where people were looking at how people recover from reconstructions and the success rate versus repairs. The problem with repairs on ACLs is the number of fibers that are torn, and also the environment where it's in a, not in a, where there's a good blood supply. It's in an area where the synovial fluid kind of interferes with the healing. But there has been, there is some work going on now to look at putting the membrane over the ACL, and particularly in young people, trying to get a recovery for ACL healing by repair instead of doing a reconstruction. When we reconstruct, there are different things that are involved. Timing is one thing, and it's important that when you, if you have an injury, you're opting for the surgical side. We want to make sure that the knee is ready for surgery. We want to be in the best shape possible going in. We want to accelerate the recovery afterwards. And if somebody goes into surgery with a stiff knee, they're going to have a stiffer knee afterwards. So patience is one of the important things. We have to look at what the other injuries are. If somebody has a displaced meniscus that's locked in the knee, then we have to get to that early. And sometimes we'll split the surgery out into two phases. Fix part of it, the meniscus and other things, and then come back when that's healed and there's enough motion. That becomes part of the prehab process, is getting the knee ready for surgery. In terms of graft selection, there are a lot of different options. It falls into two main categories, autograft versus allograft. And there aren't any hard criteria on this other than there have been some studies showing that for the young athletes, the allografts don't hold up really well. So by and large, if you've got somebody that's young, aggressive in their activities, we're going to stick with their own tissue. The advantage of an allograft, grafting from a cadaver donor, is you don't have to deal with the donor site. You have somebody else's issue and they don't care. So you don't have the pain and swelling with soreness from it, so your rehab comes along much faster, gets you back to your normal daily activities quicker. It takes longer to get the release to get back into your sports and the like, but if you're a working person and it's more important to get back to your job than your sports, which is a lot of people, then it becomes a good option. There are different options in terms of what we use for gelatin, hamstring tendon, quad tendon, and all are good options that you talk to your doctor about, what they have the best success with. There are a lot of all are good ways to go. Allograft, you use for gelatin, or soft tissue grafts, which can be any of the above. So again, they're all designed to get to the same place. And probably the more important factor in the surgery is how you do it, where you place the graft. So what is limited stress over the last 7 years is getting anatomically reconstruction, putting up where the ACL normally is. And then there's talk about single local level button, which we're not going to get into tonight. But it's basically the ACL has different components to it, and it's one of the areas that's still kind of out there in discussion on the orthopedic plan, and which way you do. And then by and large, people will favor the single button over the double button group is kind of limited now. So, anyway, all things that There's a lot of information on the internet, a lot of information available in the Bailey's checkout line. So be prepared to go and talk to your doctor and make sure that you ask questions about, you know, what's the right thing for you. Alan's going to come up and talk now on the science of rehab, what happens after you've completed the physical therapy thing, how do we get you back into your sport and get ready. You know, recovery from injury is similar to what you're looking at now when you're getting ready to ski. If you're getting ready to go back into sport coming off the injury, you need to be strong, you need to be ready. That's what we'll do, what we call functional testing or functional assessment to make sure that a person's strength is regained and they're ready before we allow them to even quit to get back to sport. Is anybody living here doing that weird?
Yeah.
Okay, well, that's coming. We're going to be out there. So, anyway, have a safe winter. Thanks again. And we'll turn it over to Alan.
All right, good evening. Thank you, Dr. Ward. My name is Alan Marikovich. I'm a physical therapist at Barton, and I'm going to talk about more of the prevention, conditioning, and performance side of the sports injuries. And just some general information is that on average, there's about 3 injuries per 1,000 skier days, and that crosses over with snowboarders also. That's just any injury that's reported pretty much. Skiers, obviously, primarily are the lower extremities, and as Dr. Ward mentioned, snowboarders are the upper extremities. So what I'd like to talk about without overlapping too much is some cause of knee injuries, some reduction in prevention techniques, awareness, reduction strategies, copers versus non-copers, where we talk about those who have had an ACL rupture and not had it repaired or not had surgery, bracing, or do we need braces, and then we'll go into more prevention and conditioning and exercises, and Caroline will come up and she'll help demonstrate some exercises that we like to use in the clinic and even before ski season to get conditioned and get strong, so hopefully we prevent injuries. So understanding the cause of the injury. I was fortunate enough to speak last week at the Vail Ski and Ride School at Kirkwood, and they had some great data they collected on their employees over the last several years. And the three top reasons they found that employees were getting injured were their physical conditioning, the terrain they were skiing, whether it was over their head or not, or for their technique or skill level, and then also their equipment. So those three things are very important when we talk about causative injury. So we're going to look at some conditioning, which includes our aerobic fitness, flexibility, fatigue, so overuse syndromes or metabolic fatigue. Once again, we have to take care of ourselves from a nutrition standpoint when we're out there. We need to stay hydrated, we need to eat, because skiing takes energy. And then, have you had a previous injury, and how does that contribute to the potential of injuring yourself again? So, understanding the cause of injury for our skill set, once again, are you a bump skier? Should you be in the bumps? Steeps, powder, burrs, trees, like you said, you can't win a battle with the trees. So. And then equipment, and this was really, really important, and I took this, when I got to listen to them talking at Kirkwood, how important really making sure your equipment, one, was tuned up properly before the season started. I mean, a lot of us, we store it away in the garage or in the attic or somewhere, and then we pull it out and go, oh, darn, I didn't get to tune this, I'm going to take it back out without getting it checked. So once again, really important thing about our equipment and what kind of shape it is to make sure our boots, the bindings, our buckles are working and everything is working properly. As Dr. Orr mentioned, that din setting, making sure your din is properly set for your skill set and the type of terrain you ski. Are you beginner, intermediate, or expert skier? Very important to take into consideration, especially early in the season. Always change those numbers later as you get more, your body gets more conditioned for the ski season. But you really have to be honest with yourself where you're at the beginning of the season. And no one can get enough ski crash videos, so.
I hurt myself today to see if I still feel. I focus on the pain, the only thing that's real. The needle tears a hole, the old familiar sting. Try to kill it all away, but I remember everything. What have I become? My sweetest friend, everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all, my empire of dirt.
I like to use the taffy analogy. If you think of a piece of taffy in the morning, it sat in your car all night, it's hard, it's brittle. Stick in your pocket for a few minutes, put it in your armpit, it's going to be nice and soft and moving. But our muscles are the same way. We want to make sure they're good and warmed up before we start going out there and you know, pushing ourselves. Exercises that we like to focus on are going to be power and stability types of exercises. And when I say landing skills up there, I don't mean 30-foot cliff hucks. I mean actually our ability to control our weight going in one direction and back to the other direction. And then as we develop strength on both legs, we like to emphasize in strengthening on one leg. I'm a big fan of balance and using exercises that always incorporate balance and incorporate the core muscles to strengthen for our functional training. And then if we get better with that, we'll develop conditioning for changing direction. So basically our ability to load one way, stop, control that motion, and go the other direction. This applies to all sports, not just skiing and snowboarding, but really important to think about when you do any sort of sport or activity. And that leads into functional training. One thing we do at the hospital and one of our clinics at our Forest Clinic on 3rd Street is we have a bridge program where we focus on an individual who has had an injury, they've gone through a formal rehabilitation program, and then they're pretty much done with their rehab. They don't really need those types of modalities and treatments anymore, but they want to get back to their sport, to get back to skiing. So we have a more functional-based exercise program that will run them through for a few months to then get them ready for a knee test to see where their injured knee now compares to their well knee. And then we'll look at, hey, are you ready to get back on the snow? Are you ready to get more sport performance oriented? So when we think of functional training, it's putting all these things together. So are we really reducing injuries or are we preventing them? Well, the goal is to prevent injuries, but no matter what we do, we can't prevent contact-related injuries. If we run into somebody, it happens. There's an impact, we get injured. But we can reduce the incidence of non-contact injuries. Did anyone see Carson Palmer tear his ACL in the NFL last week? Classic non-contact injury. He went, he pivoted, he stopped, his ACL went. Thank you.
I'm Michael Smith for Shop Talk, and here we are at the Sugar Pine Bakery in South Lake Tahoe, and we have a new addition to the family from last year's show.
Sophia Aragon.
Awesome.
Just turned 1 year old, the 6th of October. So, you're still at the hospital,
right?
Or no, not
anymore. Well, actually, I remember right that you were making my lactose intolerant cake, and it was not an easy recipe, and it was a new item that you were doing just for me and my wife, and she was so bullheaded about getting that cake done, she waited too long probably, and had to go straight to the hospital from the bakery.
Yep, and that's exactly what happened.
So that was my birthday, October 5th, and look at the precious little girl you have now.
She's good now. She's a little hungry right now.
Well, aren't we all looking at this food? But in any case, since we've been at Sugar Pine, you've done a lot of additions. You have a new bathroom, of course, which is awesome.
Yes.
And you're remodeling. The place looks fantastic.
Thank you. Yeah, we started remodeling about a year ago, maybe.
Yeah.
Right? And slowly but surely, we've been getting it to where we want. The bathroom, like Michael said, we finally got it done a couple months ago before summer started.
Well, I like the chalkboard. That's a very good addition.
Yeah, that's a homey chalkboard right there.
Who's got the talent to write so good on there?
That's me right here.
Oh, that's the artist.
Yep, that's the artist right there. You wouldn't be able to read my writing.
Probably mine either. But you've made a lot of changes, and it all looked good. And who's in charge of the changes?
Thank you. Both of us.
Both of us, yeah. He's given some ideas, I give some ideas, and we just put them all together. So we've gotten so far.
Well, I think it's everything's beautiful, and it just shows why a small business does for the community, because all these changes take money, and you've helped the community doing it.
Yeah, we've had a lot of support from our family too. Like my father, he's done a lot of the handiwork here, and my brothers as well, his family. So, yeah.
Hi, we're back, and I tell you, we just had about 40 people come through here, so we decided to take a little break to serve the patrons. And I was going to ask you, Jonathan, looks like you have a good spread of food there. Can you show us some of your items?
Oh yeah, of course. Well, we'll start off over here on the right-hand side, your left. We got our pies that we make daily. We do cherry pies, we do peach pies, Dutch apple pies, and also mixed berry pies. Now that the holidays are coming, we also do an assortment of different types of pies, like we got pumpkin pies, pecan pies, we got different cream pies. We also do feline pies and then meringue pies. So that's all for the holiday season. And you can order that, special order that any time of the year as well.
Is that something that Teresa takes care of, the pies and cakes?
Yes. Well, the different specialty pastries, that's her area. Right?
Excellent. And what's the number to call if you want to order something for a special occasion?
The number here is 520-542-7000. And we're open Tuesday through Sunday, 8 to 5.
Excellent. I noticed you have some bagels. I don't remember them last show.
No, actually these bagels are a new item that we just incorporated into our menu. So we're making bagels on the weekends. Right now I only have the blueberry left, but we have sesame seeds, we have cheese and jalapeno bagels, we have some red tomato bagels, we have all different types of bagels. So come on in, you gotta try them out to create
them. And now we're at cookies.
Yes, so we got different types of cookies. We got peanut butter, chocolate chip, our own raisin, traditional cookies that we make on a day-to-day basis. We do make special orders on different types of cookies, like snickerdoodles. We make sugar cookies, especially for the holiday season, like for Halloween, Thanksgiving, Christmas time, and so on. So, you can just give us a call.
Well, I know I've been complaining about your cookies a little bit. Every time I come in on Sundays, you're out of chocolate chip.
Yeah,
but you've been doing better, but I think you have a chocolate chip hoarder here. Somebody comes in and buys up all your chocolate chips. So I'm like, hey. So I get in trouble with the wife when I come in and I only come home with chocolate chips. So I kind of fake it and I bring home brownies instead, but she really loves your chocolate chip cookies. So I recommend coming a little bit earlier. If you come at the end of the day, you might not have your chocolate chips and your wife might cry.
We try keeping up with them, but sometimes it's hard. They're a top seller.
Unless you give us a call early in the morning, we can always make some for you and then set on the side.
Actually, that's a good comment. I took some pastry to Wave Camp, and I pre-called, and you had them ready for me to take them to Wave Camp, and awesome. It was really good stuff.
Yeah, thank
And then I think we're at the sticky buns now.
Yes, so this is a fairly new item as well. We really started making them in the beginning of June. So yeah, I mean, they're a very popular item. People really like them. They're nice and flaky because of, you know, they're made with their croissant dough, nice and moist too. So then we've got all different types of croissants early in the morning. We have plain croissants, we've got chocolate and almond croissants, or even a ham and cheese croissant for breakfast.
So ham and cheese croissants for breakfast, that sounds good.
Yeah, we warm, I mean, even nice and warm, it's even better, so we warm them up for you as well.
Excellent.
So, yeah, we have all different types of croissants, muffins as well. We do, right now we're doing pumpkin muffin, but we also have our blueberry muffin, we've got our cranberry orange, which we are sold out of right now, but that's a very popular one as well.
Yeah, I like those, and I like the blueberries too.
Yeah, and if you want more than just a muffin, we do have brulos. We got the blueberry and the cranberry orange.
Actually, we like to give those out for gifts.
Yeah.
And I recommend that if you have an idea for a birthday or an occasion, that's good eats.
People actually do that, yeah. They come and buy one, just put a bow on top.
Yeah. And actually, while we're talking about gifts, do you have like gift certificates you can get for an occasion or a birthday?
Yeah.
So just come in and get a gift certificate?
Yeah, just ask for them and then we can make them for you. Or we can. You can also do like a little box of assortment pastries. You know, we can do that too. Especially, like you said, we do that a lot for the holidays.
Well, the reason I said that, I bought the loaves for gifts before, and they didn't get given out. They got eaten at home. So I'm still apologizing to the person who didn't get their gift. So I was thinking, maybe I should have gotten a gift certificate instead and eaten the loaves anyways.
Excellent.
Well, I always think your breads are awesome too. And you have a good variety of breads here.
Yeah, we have. We make the breads fresh daily. All other pastries as well. But different types of breads that we have. We have traditional sourdough, and then we have our Tahoe sour, which we call it. And this is the whole wheat sourdough. It's a little bit more sour than the traditional sourdough. But we also have our sourdough sticks, which is a wide baguette stick. If you want something smaller, we've got our 9-grain loaf, our chipotle loaf. Spot on the sourdough we make on a day-to-day basis. Other breads, we switch them, we rotate them throughout the week. So it's not always the same type of bread. We've got a list over here of different days that we have each type of bread. Focaccias, we have those daily as well. This is tomato, rosemary, and parmesan. And then we have a three cheese focaccia as well. And our French hoagies, we like to make sandwiches. They make great sandwiches. We actually use these to make our sandwiches here at the bakery.
So you can come in and order a sandwich now?
Yeah, you can come in, you can have a sandwich, you can call us ahead of time.
Because I've had hoagies before, I didn't know you had other kinds of sandwiches.
Yeah, we make the French hoagie here, we can do it on our French baguette. Some people like the sourdough stick as well, so we can do either one of these right here. And or the focaccia as well. People have actually bought the whole focaccia and had it to make a sandwich out of it. It makes a great sandwich, so.
Yeah. Also, at the end of the day, those breads get, if there's anything left, goes to charity. I think you're at about 3 tons just from my little charities of donations throughout the couple of years you've been involved. So we really want to thank you because you've done a lot to help people in need. And it's important that for our small businesses that think that way, to protect in the neighborhood, not just, you know, the local customers, but people who can't be a customer. So I think that's awesome. You should be commended about it. And while we're commending you, I know you don't blow your own horn, but maybe you do blow your horn a little bit. There's a sign out there that says,
"One of the best in 2014.
Awesome.
We'd like to thank the community for supporting us and for choosing us. You know, we appreciate all the support that we've had from the locals in town. And we're just extremely thankful to you guys. If it wasn't for you guys, we would have never gotten that award. So.
Well, I've seen how hard you work. I think other people do as well, because it comes out the quality of your products. So, and anything you do, it makes people happy. So keep it going. And then you also have some things in the cooler, brownies I talked about, where I get my wife, if you're out of the chocolate chips.
Yeah.
But you have a variety of brownies and a variety of other products?
Yeah.
I'll just have to shoot it from here, but you can just tell me what you got. I know you got the black and white brownies, and you got the cappuccino brownies. Cappuccino?
Yeah, and then we also have, like right now we're doing mini pumpkin pies, we're doing tarts, almond pear. Definitely bread pudding, definitely recommend that one. That's one of our top sellers. Then like John said, with, you know, special order, we can do a lot more pastries for you guys. that we don't make here, you know, daily, but yeah.
Well, another thing, while you're in this area, you have first class coffee, but your chai, my wife is very obsessed with her chai tea.
Yeah.
And your chai tea qualifies for one of the places she buys it. I mean, she is extremely picky. You know, so your chai tea is a winner too.
Yeah, and then we actually, besides the chai tea, we actually just started making espresso drinks as well. So, you know, you can come in, sit down, have it with your muffin or your cinnamon roll. Yeah, and that's something new that we just started as well at the beginning of summer. So it's gone really good. We make some good espressos.
Awesome. Well, I think that's a good thing for your business.
If you're not a big fan of espressos, we also have just black coffee, you know. Oh yeah, we also have hot tea as well.
Hot tea is good.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you, I really love your presentation. Every time I come here, I get very hungry. Well, I want to, you know, thank you for all the things you've done for the community. Is there anything else you want to talk about for your business? I know you had some fruit drinks that were awesome this summer. Is that something that's going on year round?
Just during the summer.
I think I had the lemonade, and it was had some
yeah.
Some.
Yeah, we make different types of lemonades, refreshers.
Autumn Palmers,
but we also have some fresh fruit and refreshers. We have the strawberry basil. We make a blueberry mint. Raspberry mint, like I said, they're all made with fresh berries.
Well, the basil was so good, it was so fresh, I didn't even recognize it. It was, my taste buds went crazy. It's all fresh material, you know?
Yeah, all fresh material, organic orange juice, lemonade.
Yeah.
And yeah, we do only have that in the summertime because the berries are in the season, you know, right now we're in the wintertime. So we like when they're nice and sweet at the peak, you know. So definitely during the summertime, come on in and have one of those, you won't regret it. But during the wintertime, like my wife said, we have all the espresso drinks. We have the chai tea, which are great chai teas. We got two different types, maple mousse and the oral spice chai. Maple mousse is just basically a spice chai with maple in it. The orca spice, it's a spice chai that's sugar-free. It's good nonetheless. So, I mean, come on in. We got a bit of everything.
Excellent. Is there anything else we left out? Are you going to remodel again? I think everything's fine. No, I'm just kidding, because every time I came in, it seemed like things were changing, but I like your layout now. It's pretty efficient.
Yeah, we like that as well. I mean,
I know it costs you considerable money to do it, too, but it's you've done well.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we're just trying to make it our own, and slowly but surely we're getting there. So we've added some things, like you mentioned, the chalkboard, the bathroom's finally done, and we painted. And now I'm not sure we're going to do anything else.
I think we're going to be happier for
this. This is our designer, right?
He does a good job. Well, Jonathan, Teresa, thank you for being on Chop Talk, and look forward to seeing how the baby turns out. And always, thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
We appreciate you, Michael. Thank you for all your help as well.
Michael Smith reporting from Sugar Pine Bakery in Salt Lake Tahoe. Lastly, what's your phone number before we leave? Get those seasonal orders in soon.
Yes.
They're slammed around Thanksgiving and Christmas.
Oh, yes.
Okay, bye-bye.